Hello and welcome once again to this little island amid the ocean that YouTube is. I dedicate this video to my younger brother, for if you don't comprehend the past, you cannot work for a better future. As time goes by, those that are free tend to forget how oppressed life could be. On today's video, we look once again to the past. This time, to Portugal's past under dictatorship that lasted in total 48 years. In the beginning of the 20th century, the Portuguese economy continued to be based on an agriculture activity that did not demonstrate technical development. The Portuguese industry lacked funding and its biggest harbors were quickly becoming obsolete, as foreign fleets dominated the traffic of national products. The productive insufficiency provoked the rationing and the constant increase of prices, and in an attempt to respond to the difficulties, the governments would issue banknotes that were increasingly devalued, which ended up aggravating the situation. With the depreciation of the escudo, the Portuguese currency, there was a growing flight of capital abroad, which only aggravated the trade balance deficit and rose the public debt. On May 28, 1926, a military coup would overthrow the liberal republican regime known as the First Republic, which had failed to bring political stability and socio-economic growth. Instead, between 1910 and 1926, the country faced 8 presidential elections, 9 legislative elections, and 45 governments. Unable to resolve the internal divergences within the Republican Party, it was eventually dissolved into smaller factions with their own agendas, whose despise for each other did not shiver with elections. The repeated disagreements between the parties with seats in Congress made it impossible to form parliamentary majorities, and created irresolvable stalemates which many times led presidents and governments to fall. The revolt had sparked in Braga, as the revolutionaries knew that in Lisbon there would typically be few troops loyal to the government. In the 2 months that followed the coup, Portugal had 3 heads of state, none formally elected: José Mendes Cabeçada Jr., Manuel Gomes da Costa and Oscar Carmona. Each represented a different faction of the military coup, with no political project or consensus among them, as their union was restricted to the coup and the will to change the course of the republican regime. What would come next diverged according to each. Eventually, Oscar Carmona would assume leadership. Following the deposition of Gomes da Costa, Carmona would have effective powers as head of state since July 1926, by decree since November 26, and then on March 25, 1928, he was elected by direct suffrage, which was restricted to male citizens over 21 years old. With the military dictatorship that followed the 1926 military coup, the 1911 constitution was in force only in theory, and changed by successive government decrees. However, since one of the characteristics of this coup was its anti-parliamentarism, it would soon be understood that between 1926 and 1935, the idea of parliament as a sovereign body did not feature in the political priorities of power. It is during this period we can observe the rise of António de Oliveira Salazar, who would become the strategist or architect of a political new order. Invited to hold the financial portfolio and organize the nation's public accounts in 1926, Salazar initially refused it as he considered that the necessary powers to exercise a good governance were not provided to him. Only on April 1928, he would effectively accept the role after a second invite. Successfully re-elected, Oscar Carmona remained at the head of the state until his death in 1951. His support was essential in the political rise of António de Oliveira Salazar, thus contributing to the construction basis of the perpetuation of the regime, with the consequent emptying of powers of the President of the Republic. In 1933, the new constitution ended the period of transition from a military dictatorship and institutionalized a new state, the Estado Novo, constructed by Salazar and inspired by fascist ideologies. The constitution would attribute vast powers to the President of the Republic, who was elected by direct suffrage for 7-year terms. He was responsible for enacting laws, directing the state's foreign policy, appointing and dismissing ministers and the President of the Council or Prime Minister, as well as to dissolve the Assembly. The functioning of the political system would be fundamentally centralized in the President of the Council, leader of a long iron dictatorship. In the figure of Salazar, the main powers would be concentrated. As president of the single party, the National Union, he would determine the choice of the regime's candidates for the presidency of the Republic, whose holders of office would all be from the military. The presence of the opposition to the regime in the elections would later lead to an amendment of the constitution in 1951. The Council of State had to validate the political suitability of the presidential candidates. To succeed Carmona, Salazar would choose Francisco Craveiro Lopes, who would not be reappointed due to contacts he had with reformist sectors of the regime, making him the only president of the Estado Novo to serve only one term. In the presidential elections of 1958, Américo Tomás would be officially elected, and in 1959, the constitution would be amended, modifying the form of election of the President of the Republic, which would no longer be by direct suffrage, but instead was to be carried out by a restricted electoral college, formed by members of the National Assembly and the Corporate Chamber, and municipal representatives. From that moment on until the end of the Estado Novo, opposition to the regime would no longer be present in election campaigns for the presidency of the Republic. As commonly found in dictatorships, the cult to the personality was part of the regime propaganda. Salazar would be called Salvador da Pátria, savior of the homeland, and Guia da Nação, nation's guide, and would become the central figure of the governance and the intervenient in all sectors of national life. With his image always present in public spaces, contrary nonetheless to his ideological idols, Salazar's image was focused on transmitting a message of austerity, discretion, and sobriety of action. In his conservative vision, the industrial and urban world would enhance the disorder and indiscipline of modernity. The family had thus to be traditional, rural, and conservative, mirroring the morality the Portuguese society should follow. The woman's role was reduced to domestic type, submissive to her husband, profoundly feminine and passive, while the man took on the role of head of the family and provided for the household. Extreme and nationalistic, the regime viewed the existence of other political parties as potential gaps that would create harmful divisions to the nation. As such, political parties were banned, and all Portuguese of goodwill were to be part of the National Union. To achieve the union of all Portuguese, the state invested in a campaign to promote national values and enhance national cultural productions, reflecting so, creating in 1933 the SPN, the Secretariat of National Propaganda, which aimed at integrating the Portuguese society into the moral thinking that should guide the nation, thus investing in lectures, conferences, posters, booklets, theatre, sports, music, cultural manifestation and exhibitions such as the Portuguese Colonial Exhibition in 1934 and the Portuguese World Exhibition in 1940. Another important tool the regime had was education, which aimed to instill in pupils tradition, obedience, patriotism, respect for authority, and aversion to foreign modernity. In 1936, two organizations of ideological framing and defense of the nation's values were created: the Mocidade Portuguesa, Portuguese youth, a children and youth militia of compulsory membership for students of both sexes, which provided military training and organized sports and cultural activities, reconciling some facets of scouting with political and religious indoctrination, and the Legião Portuguesa, or Portuguese Legion, which was also a paramilitary institution but aimed at the civilian population. In this legion, some public workers were forced to be part of. Both organizations adopted the fascist uniform model, consisting of green shirts and brown skirts or shorts, and the Roman salute, later abandoned in 1945. A characteristic of the Mocidade Portuguesa attire was a belt in which the buckle had an S that symbolized Salazar's initials and whose meaning was to serve. At a corporate level, economic and social life was organized in corporations. While work activity was controlled by corporations, the organization and occupation of people's free time was also to follow the regime morals, thus the creation of FNAT, the National Foundation for Joy at Work. To further indoctrinate the population with family life values, the regime created as well the Works of Mothers for National Education, which aimed to train the future women and mothers of the regime. And, as in other dictatorships, censorship was a core part of the regime. On October 22, 1945, the International and State Defense Police, known as PIDE, was created at the height of the Estado Novo. Its main purpose was to pursue, arrest and interrogate any individual who was seen as an enemy to the dictatorship, anyone seen as a threat or that dared to defy even the most obscure rules of the regime were taken by Pete. Many sent to prisons of Fort of Caxias and Peniche or Tarrafal on the island of Santiago in the Cape Verde archipelago. It was also under Pete's functions to direct the censorship. One of its most famous processes would become known as the Blue Pencil, since all press articles and works of art such as literature, theatre, cinema, plastic arts were banned or cut and edited before being allowed to be published with a blue pencil. The PIDE was such a loathed part of the regime that it would later be dissolved, yet in truth, it would carry on under a different name, when on the same day, November 24, 1969, the DGS, or Directorate-General for Security, was formed. Commonly referred to as Salazar's financial miracle, much aided by the Portuguese neutrality in the Second World War, the financial stability was possible due to the economic activity submission to the ulterior interests of the state, where their main economic characteristics were the protectionism and interventionism, with the goal of becoming autosufficient. Through the colonies, we find a flow of metropolitan agriculture and industrial products and the supply of raw materials at a low cost. And by launching new infrastructural projects, the regime created new jobs and projected an image of prosperity. The new political order imagined by Salazar was therefore based in four institutions. The União Nacional, which was an official political force created by the government in 1930 that would later become the only authorized party. The Colonial Act, which was approved in 1930, reasserted the Portuguese presence as civilizing missions in the overseas territories. It defined the relationship between the territories and Portugal as one of dependency and ended the overseas territories' opening to foreign intervention. The Colonial Act would also end the administrative decentralization policies. The National Labour Statute, enacted in 1933, regimented the corporative organization of the national productive system. And finally, the 1933 Constitution, which ended the period of transition from a military dictatorship and institutionalized the Estado Novo. Portuguese fascism assumed all the characteristics of the Italian model, especially its corporatism. The totalitarian inspiration was also present in the conservative, nationalist, anti-parliamentary, authoritarian, dirigist and repressive character of the regime. Salazar thus designed the Estado Novo, an authoritarian and semi-presidentialism regime in which the executive power was, in fact, held by the president of the government, which overlapped the president of the republic. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed the video, don't forget to like and subscribe, and stay safe.